Hey, welcome, church. It is so good to be all the way here, you know, from the church to your home. And whatever you are, just go ahead and prepare your heart and join us to worship Jesus this morning. Will you join me in pray? Father, we thank you so much for who you are. We thank you for Jesus. And Jesus, we thank you for your love, for your grace, for dying for us. We are ready to get to know you, get closer to you this morning. In Jesus' mighty name, and everyone said, amen. Come on, let's sing along.
Praises rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. When we see you, we find strength to face the day. In your presence, all our fears are washed away, washed away.
You are the God who saves us, worthy.
find our peace.
Oh Lord, my God, in you I put my trust. Oh Lord, my God, in you I put my hope. Oh Lord, my God, in you I put my trust.
Oh Lord, my God.
Oh Lord, my God, in you I put my hope. In you I find my peace. In you I find my strength. In you I live and move and breathe.
Let everything I say and do, come on.
Let everything I say and do keep coming by my faith in you. Lift up holy hands and sing, let the praises ring.
Yeah.
Oh Lord my God, to you I give my hands. Oh Lord my God, to you I give my feet.
Yes God.
Oh Lord my God, you I give my everything. Oh Lord my God, to you I give my life.
You guys are ready, come on. One, two.
In you I find my peace. In you I find my strength. Lift up holy hands and say, let the praises ring.
Let the praises ring, come on. Hey. Yeah, you can put your hands like this, come on. Hey. Come on, let's celebrate, right there, come on.
Faithful forever you will be. promises, yes and amen. All your promises, yes and amen.
Receive the message in Jesus' mighty name. And everyone said, amen. God bless you.
Hey, good morning, Fountain family. I'm glad to be joining you from your living room or wherever you're watching this from right now. My name is Pastor Grant. I'm the student pastor here at the Fountain Church. And today is our online service, the last Sunday of the year. And if it's your very first time joining us, I'm really grateful that you've set aside this time to join in and worship with us today. We'd love for you to go to connect.thefountain.church and fill out a Connect card. We have a free gift we'd love to send to your home. It's one of these beautiful Christmas ornaments. It's the day after Christmas, but hey, it's still super nice, and we'd love to send that to you since it's your first time here. Also, today before we get into the service, I'd love to encourage all of us, wherever you're at, just to go ahead and prepare the elements of communion. At the end of the service today, we're going to be receiving that together. And even though we're not in the same space, we're still going to be united with one another and with Christ and the church throughout the rest of the world today through that sacrament, through that communion. So go ahead and make sure you have that set before we get to the end of the service. My friends, let's turn our hearts to God and yield ourselves to His Holy Spirit today. Heavenly Father, we thank You for this day, for the time that we get to spend together and with You. We offer ourselves to You and just say, have Your way. Change anything in us that needs to be changed and draw us closer to one another and closer to You today. We love You. You are so good. And we pray all of this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And everyone said, amen.
Good morning, and may I say, I pray that you had the most wonderful Christmas wherever you were and whoever you were with. I pray that this Christmas was your most favorite Christmas. We thank you for joining us here. We're all online today for our last service of the year, but I just want to thank you. And if this is your first time joining us online, we especially want to thank you for joining us. And if you would fill out the digital Connect card, we'd love to send you a free gift in the mail. How many of you regularly start one book and then pick up another book before you finish the first one? How many of you have a little project at home which has been sitting there waiting to be finished? It may be a cross stitch that you've never gotten around to finishing. It may be a picture that you've bought that has never made it onto the wall. Maybe that you are in the middle of something and, well, it has never gotten done. How many of you have ever started something and never completed it? Why do we do that, I wonder? Why do we start something and many times don't finish it? Maybe it's because we lose interest. Maybe something better has come along. Maybe we have grown tired of struggling to finish it. Maybe we lack the discipline to finish it. Maybe we've chosen to busy ourselves with other things. We could list plenty of excuses, couldn't we? But the fact is that probably we all have things that are not finished. If that's you, then you're not alone. 2022 is breaking its way into our lives in just a few days. But before it does, I wanted to remind us all of something. There may be something that needs finished before you get into 2022. There may be something unfinished or unresolved, unforgiven or undone. There may be something that's not completed, not decided, not handled. There are those things that will transcend the year, that will cross the threshold from 2021 to 2022. It can't be helped. But what about what God has wanted you to complete in 2021 that has been left unfinished? Counting today, there are just 6 days left to finish what you've been called to finish. Do you have it in you? Do you have the heart of a finisher? That's today's message to all of us. God wants us all to have a heart of a finisher. A man was trying hypnosis to help him quit smoking. His friend asked whether he thought it would work, and he said, sure, it worked the last time I tried it. Let's face it, starting well is relatively easy, but finishing well is a different matter altogether. Starting that new diet or that exercise program is kind of fun, but hanging in over the long haul is a real test. Getting married is exciting and relatively easy. Staying married, though, comes with struggles, comes with adjustments and trials, and it's not always an easy matter. The same is true of the Christian life. Becoming a Christian is relatively easy. Acknowledge to God that you are a sinner and receive the faith, the free gift of eternal life that comes from knowing Christ and that He provided by the shedding of His blood on the cross. You cannot work for your salvation, nor do anything to qualify for it. God gives it freely to all that recognize their need and trust in Christ alone. But then comes the hard part. hanging in there as a Christian in a world that is hostile towards God and His people. The world constantly dangles in front of you all that it has to offer, and it's all in opposition to the things of God. From within, the flesh entices you to forsake Christ and gratify your sinful desires. The enemy hits you with temptation after temptation after temptation. The real test of your faith is, will you endure it? Can you finish? Genuine faith in Christ perseveres to the finish line. Scripture teaches us this. Some people say that having the end in mind helps to get us started and keeps us going. Even when we face hurdles and hindrances, and it keeps our progress from moving forward. I'm going to share a scripture with you now from the Apostle Paul out of 2 Timothy 4. It says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. Wouldn't it be great to be able to say that? Does that motivate you knowing that this is what God desires for you? If it motivated Paul and so many others that we read about in Scripture, maybe you've known someone whose life embodied those same words that Paul spoke in Scripture. How do you want people to remember you? Do you have the heart of a finisher? Just before his team left the locker room to play for the national championship of the college football at the Fiesta Bowl in January 2003, Jim Tressel, head coach of the Ohio State Buckeyes, gathered his team for one final talk. After going over the game plan, he asked his team one simple question. How do you want to be remembered? It must have worked because when the game was over, the Buckeyes had pulled off one of the greatest upsets, defeating the Miami Hurricanes, in the process ending their 34-game winning streak and winning the national championship. Go Buckeyes! The question, though, hangs in the air. How do you want to be remembered? I'm not talking about the end of your life, though, although we need to be concerned about that. And I do understand that all of the little moments in our life are being remembered, culminate into who we really are. So it's important how we want to finish well at the end of this life. But no, how do you want to be remembered at the end of this year, at the end of 2021? Before we ever enter into 2022, what are people saying about you? What are they thinking about you? What are they feeling about you? What and how will you finish? The writer of the book of Ecclesiastes in your Bible says this, in chapter 7, verse 8, it says, the end of a thing is better than its beginning. Let me say that again. The end of a thing is better than its beginning. You have 6 days. We have 6 days beginning today to finish well, to make the end of 2021 better than 2022. I said that wrong. To make the end of 2021 the best it can be. What will you do? How will you do it? Who will you go to? Where will you go? Friends, these are very important questions. Because we need to end this year well. The end, the finish of something should be better than its beginning. Finishing strong, finishing well. God loves the heart of a finisher. The Word of God has some very timely and to the point words to say about finishing well. In Hebrews 12, it says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders, and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race that is marked out for us. You see, there's a plan. There's a goal. There's a job. There's a commission. And we must finish what we have started, what God has told us to start. He has also ordained for us to finish. God gave us all instructions in 2021. We all had commands to obey from God. We all had things to complete as part of our race from 2021. Can you say that you persevered? Can you say in 6 days that you fulfilled all that God had for you to fulfill in 2021? Paul told us in 1 Corinthians 9:24, do you not know that in a race all the runners run, but only one gets the prize? Run in such a way as to get the prize. Did you run in such a way as to get a prize in 2021? You have 6 days left. There's a well-known axiom for the one who wants to make sure they don't miss anything God wants to accomplish through them. It goes like this: pray like it depends on God and work like it depends on you. The thing to remember is that God won't do what you are supposed to do, and you can't do what God is supposed to do. It takes both of us together. When God gives us a vision, He gives us the provision. He makes a way. He walks with us. He gives us the strength and all that we need to accomplish all that He's called us to do. But somewhere along the line, we've made excuses. The point is, did you do what God asked you to do? Are you doing it now? Are you trying to finish well? Will you finish well? Galatians 5:7 tells us, you were running well. Who hindered you from obeying the truth? That's insinuating there are people or things in our lives that we allow to get in the way of us completing and running well the race God has put in front of us. Sometimes the reasons for not finishing something or accomplishing something specifically God has called us to do is because we get off track. We got lazy, we got focused on something else, we listened to the lies of the evil one. We should always look at ourselves first before we reason that it was someone else's fault that we didn't do what we were called to do. It's easy to point the finger and blame somebody else for something that we were supposed to do. But that being said, there may have been someone or something that hindered us from doing all that God required of us. It's always a good thing to evaluate why or why not something was accomplished and how it was accomplished along the way. Evaluation is important and necessary in our lives. And friends, we must all remember that we are not alone in the race that we are called to run. Doing all that God requires us also requires God in us. We can't accomplish Holy Spirit-powered accomplishments without the Holy Spirit power. And just because we have the Holy Spirit power doesn't mean that we're tapping into it. That is important to understand. Do your parents or grandparents ever tell you stories about things that happened before you were born? You ever had that experience? Perhaps they talk about games they played growing up or people they met while traveling or family members who you've never met or heard of. But when you gather together for holidays or special occasions, do they ever talk about the things that God had done for them? In Deuteronomy 11, Moses reminds the people of Israel all that God has done for them from the day God first told Pharaoh to let his people go, to the day that they crossed over the Red Sea, right up to the moment they prepared to cross into the Promised Land after nearly 40 years of wandering in the desert. Within those verses, God tells his people to carry his words and commands in their heart and in their soul and to always keep them someplace where they would always be reminded of what God had said and done. Have you ever sat down to do that? To recall all that God has said and done in your life? To remember how faithful God has been? In 1 Samuel, we see the prophet Samuel taking this commandment seriously. When God heard the people's cry for deliverance, Samuel erects a stone of remembrance. Let me read to you out of 1 Samuel. Then Samuel took a stone and set it up between Mizpah and Shen and called its name Ebenezer. For he said, till now the Lord has helped us. You see, building an altar was a symbol of worship that also acted as a powerful symbol and reminder of what God had commanded of his people. It was also a reminder how the people had responded by obeying or disobeying God's commands and how God blessed or disciplined them as a result of their choices. Years later, when children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren would pass by the stone, they would be reminded of the family stories their parents and their grandparents told them. The stone wasn't just a reminder of God's promise to them. It was a reminder of the promise God's people made to him, to worship him. to worship Him alone, to live their lives in such a way that all the world would know that God is the Lord of all and that He is worthy of all our praise and all our worship. You see, that is a reminder not just to remember who God is, but a reminder for us to keep on trusting God. When Samuel set up the memorial stone, he called it Ebenezer. Maybe you've heard of that name recently in the Christmas story about a man called Ebenezer Scrooge. I've said multiple times, it's one of my favorite Christmas movies, A Christmas Story. But when we think of Mr. Scrooge, we often think of someone who doesn't like Christmas and is a very selfish man. But the word Ebenezer actually means stone of help. When we listen to the story, we discover that as long as Scrooge is being selfish, everyone suffers. Even him. But when he repents of his selfishness and begins caring for others, things change for everyone. Like the remembrance stone in 1 Samuel, the spirits of Christmas past, Christmas present, and Christmas future are sent as reminders of who Ebenezer, of who he really is supposed to be, and what will happen to him and those around him if he doesn't start living the way he's supposed to. You see, that story relives itself in our lives. You see, if we're mean and we're angry and we're hateful to people, everybody suffers. But if we're kind, we're unselfish, we're generous, everyone wins. When the people of Israel forgot about where they came from, they forgot about all that God had done for them. And everyone suffered. But when they were reminded of the truth and asked for God's forgiveness for disobeying Him, God helped them overcome the enemies who were attacking them. When we take the time to remember the things God has done for us and for our families, it reminds us that God is always faithful and that He cares about what happens to us. When we remember how God helped us with the hard things in the past, it's easier to trust Him when we face hard things in our present and in the future. And we're less afraid about the hard things we may or may not face in the future. When we can remember and walk in this, it's much easier to have the heart of a finisher because we know what God has begun in us, His promise to complete it. Let me share with you a scripture that you've heard many times. Philippians 1:6 says, "Being confident of this, that he who began a good work will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus." Let me say that one more time. Being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you and in me will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. You see, God comes along with us. We don't have to do it by ourselves. We have the strength of the Holy Spirit, God's Spirit in us, to be a great finisher, to have the heart of a finisher. These experiences of God's faithfulness, God doing what He said He would do, should encourage us to be faithful finishers. Each of us has been changed in the past year by God's grace in both challenging and in joyful ways. Remembering these things can empower us to finish what is before us, give us the courage to move into the future. This is a new year coming upon us, full of God-sized accomplishments, waiting to be started, but also to be finished. Can God trust you to finish what He's called you to start? Let me encourage you in this. Scripture tells us that when we are faithful in the small things, we are then being prepared for the greater things, to be entrusted with the greater things. That's the way God works. He wants to see us faithful. He wants to see us finish what He's called us to begin. God is looking for people who have the heart of a finisher. And I want to ask you again, is that you? In these next 6 days, will you sit down today even and think about all the things that you have started that maybe you didn't finish? Maybe there's some things that you can't even finish now, but maybe there is something that you're supposed to finish. Maybe you began this thing about reaching out to somebody to share the gospel, and you hadn't yet done that. There's no greater time than now to finish that, to do what God has commanded all of us to do, is to share the gospel with somebody, to share Jesus and teach them everything God has commanded, and there's no greater way to share it than through your own testimony. So maybe that's what you need to finish. Maybe you need to find somebody to do that. Maybe you need to go ask for forgiveness or forgive somebody that needs it before you move into 2022. We don't need to take things into 2022 that were supposed to be finished in 2021. So I'm encouraging, I'm praying for you and with you that you would take a moment, evaluate, think about, and then do what God has commanded you to do. In closing today, I want to share a couple more scriptures about finishing, about doing what God's called us to do. Philippians 3, Paul tells us, brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. You hear that? I press on. I'm not going to let these hurdles and these hindrances get in my way of finishing. I press on. I'm going to work through the hard stuff. I'm going to jump over the hurdle. I'm going to go around the hurdle. I'm going to get rid of the hurdle. In 2 Timothy 4:7, he says, I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. You know, at the end of our lives, this is something that we all should aspire to be able to say. I've done many funerals where this scripture has been used about the person who has passed on or transitioned from this world. They have fought the good fight. They have finished their race, and they have kept the faith. You see, ultimately, that's what we all aspire to. But can we have that same heart, that same attitude in every day, in this next year coming up, and finishing this present year? To press on towards the goal, to fight, to finish the race, to keep the faith. God is looking for the faithful. God is looking for those who will keep their word as he has kept his word. Will that be you this year? As we segue into communion, we think about the ultimate, the epitome of a finisher, having the heart of a finisher, and that's Jesus Christ. We just celebrated his birth yesterday. We celebrated the birth of a Savior, a Messiah, come Emmanuel, that God came from heaven and made his dwelling with us. He came as a baby and he lived his life to accomplish something, to finish something that God had asked him, his own Father had asked him to do. And it was something no one else could do. Let me read to you out of John 19:30. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit. You see, Jesus went through all that his Father had asked him. He did everything that his Father had asked him to do. Were there instances of the human side of him, the man, fully man and fully God, the fully man side of him that maybe thought, is this worth it? Can I do this? We can think about when he was in the garden, when he said, Father, if it's your will, let this cup pass by me, but not my will, your will. And he knew the will of the Father, and he pressed on. He pressed forward. He fought the good fight. He pressed on to the finish, to the cross, and he knew what was ahead of him. And he said, it is finished. It is completed. I have done what the Father has asked me to do. I have done it. And then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. What an incredible day for all believers. Because by that and by his resurrection, which is the full gospel, don't stop at the cross. Don't stop at the tomb. He rose from the dead. He's the ultimate finisher. And we're to follow Jesus. I pray with all my heart that you will strive to have a heart of the finisher, that whatever God has called you to do, that you will work to complete with all your heart. We have a Savior to follow, an incredible example to lift up and to follow and to worship, and we should do that because of what he did for us. Now, right now, I pray that you've prepared it in your home, but we'll take communion together. The body of Christ that was broken for us, that was pierced on the cross. The blood, the cup, which represents his blood that flowed from the cross, because without the shedding of blood, Scripture says, there's no forgiveness. And so we need what Christ did so that we could be one with God, that we can be reconciled back to the Father. If you've never accepted Christ as your Lord and Savior, I would encourage you to think about maybe that's the finishing that you need to do. You need to make that decision. Maybe you've thought about it a lot. It's time to finish that thought. And you can reach out to me or someone around you. Mike@thefountain.church is my email. I would love to talk to you. You can email me and we'll chat about that. Christ is calling you to have the heart of a finisher, to be part of his family. But for those of us that are, we celebrate this in this moment together by taking communion. And we remember the sacrifice that Christ made, and we are full of gratitude. So I encourage you to do that now. Let me have a word of prayer, and then we'll take communion together. Father in heaven, we love you so much. Thank you. Thank you for looking ahead and knowing what we needed. And thank you for sending your son. Jesus, thank you for coming and starting something, and not only starting, but you finished it. And we thank you for being the finisher. Because without that, we would not have salvation. We would not be reconciled back to God. We would not have the chance at heaven. So Jesus, thank you. And Holy Spirit, thank you for residing in all who trust Jesus as their Lord and Savior. You come and make your home in us. And you have the power to help us do, to help us start, and to help us finish. And we need to tap into that power because you are there for us. So in this time right now, Father, we thank you. We give you praise and glory and ask you to bless this communion to your glory and to our remembrance. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Family and friends, I want to thank you for joining us for our last worship service of 2021. In just a few days, we'll be entering a new season in 2022. Let me just say thank you to those of you who have been faithful. Faithful to God, faithful to His Word, and faithful to His church. We serve a faithful and generous God, and many of you have followed His example and have grown in generosity. We serve a generous God. It is and always will be my responsibility to remind us all to remember to bring in honor of God our tithes and our offerings. This is biblical and it is our worship. God will bless what you bring in faith and bless and multiply what you sow in obedience into His kingdom. My encouragement to you is to continue to grow in your generosity to God and to His church. My encouragement to you, if you have found your lacking to grow in your faithfulness to God and His church, is there is no time like the present. There are 6 days before 2022, and you can finish well. God accepts us where we are, but His heart is for us to become like His Son. I pray that you do and become all that God has planned for you. Now, in reference to our Thanksgiving offering, which we have been holding through November and through December, it's for capital expenditures of the church property. The physical property has desperately needed some maintenance and upgrades. This is a beautiful place to invite our neighbors and our family and most assuredly lost people to find Jesus. We will take the first 10% of our total funds raised and donate them to missions. We tithe as members of God's church, and His church will certainly tithe from the financial blessings to help others in their mission for God as well. So let me just say how proud and how excited I am to be serving God alongside each of you, faithful people. We believe together that God can and will do immeasurably more than we can ever dream or imagine. So to the update. Last update, we raised just over $22,000 of our $30,000 goal, and our participation percentage was at 44%. To date, we have raised $37,429.37, and our participation percentage is up to 51%. Let's give God the praise and the glory He deserves. He is a good God. Now, this is not the last time you can give. We have 6 more days till the end of the year that you can give towards this Thanksgiving offering goal. There will be one last update on January 2nd after the last gifts and donations come in. Now let me speak a moment to the beginning of the year. January 2nd, we'll begin our 21-day prayer and fasting for the lost. Our community of believers will come together and pray and fast together for the lost people in our community and in our lives. So January 2nd, I'm believing for every person committed to the vision and mission of the Fountain Church to pray and to fast for 21 days. We will commit to pray for our hearts and the hearts of our brothers and sisters, for them to become sensitive and to have more urgency to plant seeds of salvation and share the saving gospel with those who are at this moment lost to heaven. And also our hearts and prayers will be for the lost to find salvation, to hear the Spirit calling, and to respond. Keep this in your mind as you're praying. How will they know unless someone tells them? So our prayer and fast will kick off at 5 p.m. on January 2nd, where we will, I hope that everyone will join us to pray in the neighborhoods, the 17 neighborhoods that are on Old Fountain Road from 5 o'clock to 6 o'clock. We're asking you to go into those neighborhoods, one of them, drive or walk, and just pray to God for the people who are hurting, the people who need to come back to church, but most especially for the people who are lost to Jesus right now. They need His saving grace, the salvation that He brought with Him. You will also get the opportunity to sign up for multiple times to do this very same thing on your own time throughout the 21-day prayer fast. We will have posters representing each subdivision and 21 slots for you to choose where you will pray that particular day and sign your name in that slot. They'll be available to sign up on January 2nd. I'll have more to share about this when we deliver that message on January 2nd. So let me close by saying again, there are 6 days left in 2021 before we enter a new season in 2022. Do you have the heart of a finisher? Is there something you need to finish before a new season begins? My prayer is that you would do all God asks you now so that you can begin and receive all that He has for you in 2022. So God's favor and His blessing be poured out to overflowing in your life and in the life of your family as you take every step in obedience to His will for your life. We'll see you in 2022.